based in London right now and working. So he agreed to come over and have a quick chat to you just about his experience as a swimmer in Hong Kong and then progressing to Stanford University. He swam in 2008. He swam in multiple international meets, world championships, world university games, Asian games, medalists. So I'm going to pass it over to him, and he's just going to give you a brief insight into his sort of swimming career, and then he's going to open up the floor if you want to ask any questions. You can go ahead and ask some questions. We'll gladly answer. So, Geoffrey.
Hi, guys. So, as David was saying, I grew up in Hong Kong. I swam, started swimming at LFC. Any of you know LFC? So I was at LFC with the rights, and I went to West Island. Throughout my time here in Hong Kong, I competed at pretty much all the same swim meets as you, you know, Masters Invitational. I never went up to Beijing like you will probably do. But I was right here with you, and I did all the same swim meets as you all. I basically, when I was 10 years old, I saw Ian Thorpe swim in Sydney, and thus ignited my dream to go swim in the Olympics. And I failed twice qualifying for the Olympics. First time was for Beijing in 2007, 2008. I just wasn't ready for where I needed to be. So I said, okay, I'm gonna go next time. And then at that point, that's when I graduated from high school. And I went to Stanford University, as David was saying. And whilst I qualified for the London Olympics in 2012, they changed the rules and put the number of quota on the number of swimmers that could go. And so I didn't go to London, and so I was really disappointed. So from there, I was like, right, going next time. And in 2016, I finally went, qualified, and I won my heat in Rio, but unfortunately just missed a semi-final, two tenths, something like that. And then from there, I kind of reflected, and I now work in London as a software engineer, but I still miss swimming a little bit. So that's kind of like the overview of my story, but I started to get serious with swimming when I was about probably 14 or 15, that's when I really, probably 15, that's when I really committed and quit like all the other sports that I used to do, like basketball, tennis, golf. Ran a bit across the country. But I will leave it up to you to ask me questions, whatever you want to hear, I'll try my best to answer. So.
Yeah, I think it would be a good opportunity to pick someone's brain to this week's finish of your sport, your training sport. So use the time you have to really gain a little bit more knowledge and insight into your mind.
Yeah.
What was your biggest motivation?
My biggest motivation. Probably proving to myself that I could get there. I think that was probably a really big one. I think that was like a big driving force. And then also just wanting to be, you know, as good as I could be at anything I do. And I applied that not only to swimming, but to school as well, to whatever I do in life. And that's the beauty of sport, that you, it's not like you're sitting in a classroom, right? You're out here moving, you're playing, you're with your friends. But it's about the mentality that you take from there, and you just like transfer it to everything. It was hard. I would say it probably took me 2 years to really get the hang of. I went through a different, so I did like British A levels, so it was a bit different to your schooling that you were getting here. So there was a bit of a learning curve for that as well, a continuous assessment. For us, we had like, you know, the year where, okay, we would get grades, but then come the end of the year, that's when you like had to knuckle down, kind of like in swimming where you have a neat taper at the end, right? I would say that swimming is like maybe the toughest sport. as you will now, you will have to make sacrifices if you want to be good or great. So for me, it was about like really managing my time effectively, more so than I did in school, and just getting the job done and asking for help.
In terms of your management of time, it must be more difficult to be trained at LRC or trained in China. You live off the land, lots of travel. Here is a little bit different, right? Management of time should be easier for you guys compared to everyone back to do lots of traveling. So it's having to use time traveling to actually do lots of stuff.
Yeah, so luckily I live close to school, but I didn't always, like, I trained.
Lowest point in your career, and how did you make it through that?
My lowest point in my career.
Like, how did you, like, power through it?
Firstly, it's mindset. When you hit a low point, if it's in life or if it's in school, your mindset should be a growth mindset, and that should be, you should ask yourself, first thing, like, reflex, what can I learn from this experience? So my low point, I had several low points. Probably each time I didn't go to the Olympics. My first year at Stanford, when I didn't get selected to go to Pac-10s back then, now Pac-12s. Being injured my junior year and not being able to race in the early part of the season. How did I learn from that? It's like all about fundamentals, analyzing where you can go better, like working with your coach to find out what you can do better, and like really committing to that, creating a little plan around it. Or if it's in school with your teacher, so you didn't get the grade that you wanted, instead of like saying, okay, when I sit down with you after class, or at some point, I want to go over, my test and see where I can improve and where can you think. And then from then on, it's like, actually sitting down and creating that time in your day and doing it.
During high school, how many times per week did you swim? During high school, how many times per week did you swim?
it ranged. It probably went from. So when you say high school, is that freshman year onwards?
It doesn't matter.
Yes.
Yeah. How old? How old? Age?
14. At 14, I was probably doing 5-6 sessions. 5-6 sessions a week, and then by the end of it, probably 8. And then when
Geoffrey is a male swimmer, so the amount of workouts that he would be doing as a male swimmer is enough, right? Sometimes for girls or female athletes, early developers, manly swimmers, distance swimmers, the amount would be really good. Sure, but for male sprinters or male athletes, 3, 5, 6, 7 workouts. Swam about 4 workouts a week through this whole age group of males. And when the Olympic Games won, we only really started to swim seriously when he was 16. There can be outliers in male swimming.
Why did you like choose swimming as like your sport too? Because you said that you didn't used to do like basketball at all.
Yeah.
So like, why did you choose swimming out of all those?
I think a combination of, not that I wasn't good at the other sports, but it's a combination of like what you're good at, I started swimming first, and it's a combination of what you're good at, what your aspirations are, but also practical things like, you know, is there an environment for it? In Hong Kong, swimming is one of the sports that you have sort of an environment for it. Like Hong Kong's really not known for sport, for sporting success. But in the club that I swam for, we have history of, you know, former Olympians. Whereas in Hong Kong, there's no history for basketball or tennis, really, or golf.
So like, where do you find joy?
Where, like, I
joy? Yeah, like, you know, like, genuine question.
Yeah. Perfectly valid. How many of you know what the word mindfulness means?
Yep.
You
specs.
You can like volunteer like what the meaning of being mindful is. Yeah. Yeah. And being present, right? One of the joys of how many of you have heard of like, you know, the runner's high? And that's not weed, by the way. Yeah? So when like the runner's high is when you get into this flow state, or the equivalent would be when you're doing homework and you're in the zone and you know everything's going well, right? And someone talks to you, you can't hear them because you're so focused. Part of the enjoyment for me in swimming is when I get to the pool, it's just, you know, let's do it. And focus, and it's being in that state for like 2 hours of the day, 4 hours of the day, and really, you know, you chemically your body will release endorphins when you're working hard and you're focused, and there's that element. The joy of it is as well. I mean, swimming's hard. When you put in hard hours and you go to a meet and you go best time, it is very evident. You either went faster or slower, right? It's very evident that whatever you've done, you're a better version of yourself. And it's noticing that. So improving at a meet, right, takes a bit longer, right? You're not competing every day, but in workout, you're doing it every day, and so you can find little things. You know, maybe you haven't figured out how to flow really well yet, or maybe you haven't figured out how to get a certain rate in your stroke yet. Maybe you haven't figured out how to go for double kicks off every board yet. And when you do achieve that, it's important to. That's when like you find like little things, little sparks of joy here and there. It's not actually not all about, you know, winning the race or the best time at the end, even though that is like the cherry on the top. So there are a variety of meets in Hong Kong. There's a festival sport that's like their qualifying meet. But for me, my approach ever since I was 12 really was to go overseas and race, because the level standard there is higher than it is in Hong Kong. And luckily, I think most of you can have that opportunity. in terms of the meets in Hong Kong, like the big ones you should probably focus on are probably festivals for. That's generally one that, you know, you'll get picked for a team or someone. But I wouldn't place as much emphasis on short course camps. It is really important when you get to refine your turns and your starts and all that. That's really important for short course. Process, right? So for me, when I was here in Hong Kong in high school, the big thing was like festival score in November, Asian camps, those were the two. Elsewhere in the world, the rest of the world, the big meet generally is right smack bang in the middle of the summer, July, August. So for me, I didn't mention earlier, every year from about 12 onwards, I actually went to the British Nationals, like British as well, and I competed there in the summer. And that was my main meet of the year. So for Beijing, I tried to qualify at the British Championships, which was a bit earlier, right, because the Olympics is in the summer. So April climbing, an important month. And then after that, at university, for me, it was, at that point, I had already, you know, pretty much got the time to qualify for any team I wanted in Hong Kong. So it was more about, can I be on it?
Yeah, I think it's a good question to ask. I think a lot of it can be determined by sort of body composition. Generally, if you're feeling water float, the better position you're able to get your body to be in without moving in, you're more on the distance side. Yeah, if you get in and you go a dead line of flow, you're actually upright. Normally, as you progress, as you get older, your rotation or the way you sit in the water naturally can change.
I can't feel that.
Like this.
Not
100 times.
You'll naturally excel, right? That's why it's important to try all kinds of different things when you're younger. You go to swimming, like the Mantis Invitational, you're swimming every event except for the 400 and 800 and 1500, right?
As an age group, you swam every event.
Yeah, it doesn't mean it's like some of my best times are friends. It's still like I've done 100 reps since.
Yeah, I think as an age group swimmer, you're very, very driving. Swim everything, distance all the way down the strip, and then as you progress and get to college, then you're sort of put into where they feel is best, or where the college team actually needs you. One of the swimmers I think is in Hong Kong, Stephanie Adams, she still actually is the 1500 meter national record holder. She now swims to the back. What the college team wants from you.
Yeah.
Are you still planning on going back to Olympics?
I don't know. I might be done. I'm not sure. For now, I'm done.
What exactly were like your times? Like when you were like, no, like to get in. Like, you know, what exactly were times like when you were like senior, I guess, like in Snap, and those like schools were like college.
Oh, when I was a senior in high school.
Yeah, high school.
So my best time is going into Stanford. Right, I never swapped your idea before. So 53 long course, so I was 23.8.
Oh.
103 I was.
Yeah, that's so easy.
52 flat. 100 back. I was 50 back, I was like 27 flat. 100 back, I was 58 low. 200 back, I was 207. 100. Did I say 103? I think those were really my main five. Yeah. And the short course meters, I think I was like 50.4. 56 flat, 100 back, 25, 9, 50 back. My car back to us. Yeah, so I only applied to one school, but I had like verbal things from Cal and Western. The application for athletes. Stanford was a bit different, right? I had to apply to the school early, and then only if I got in, I'd be in the school team. So I had to apply early in I think mid-September, and I found out I got in mid-October. So basically, coaches in the US don't look overseas. So I basically got to, I actually went to a swim camp in Stanford, established a relationship there, sent them a video, sent them my swim camp through, library and stuff. But that's the attitude, right? You have to go get it, right? At school here, in the water, everything you do, go get it. Yeah, so when I was swimming more frequently, like college on, I maybe had like 2 or 3 weeks a year, or maybe like weekly NCAAs. In high school, it was less. Well, sorry. I don't think I had like swept to a break, to be honest, in high school. Like, when I had exams, I turned down the training. But I can't really remember, to be honest. Like generally in the summer when you're away and you're not in like your normal training environment, I would have 3 weeks for sure. Yeah. But that being said, like kids in America, high school kids, and they train really hard. Like, way harder than I ever did here. That's yeah. And they probably have less break.
So maybe take two more questions. And then we'll tie it up. Alice.
Um, 2K per time, why is it useful? I mean, at this stage, how old are you? 16? It's about building, like, endurance, just, like, trust your coach. It's like, honestly, trusting your coach is super important. It can really make or break your season. I had a few years where, you know, I just didn't trust my coach, and who knows what I've done in those couple of years, and now my career is basically on. So, you know, if you don't trust your coach, maybe have a conversation as to why, or like, what are you afraid of, right? But if you trust your coach and like trust in the process, and know that they probably know more than you do, and if you're confused, ask, like, why am I doing this? How's it gonna get better? How's it gonna make me get better? Or if you're struggling with what you, you know, what to work on that day, ask, right? They watch you. They're watching you every day. Yeah.
Oh, like, what did your diet look like?
My diet? I didn't really drink any alcohol at all. At most, I was having like 5,000 calories a day when I was in training for Rio. But that was more in like a phase where I was doing lots of strength, where I was trying to, you know, increase muscle mass, stuff like that. Generally, I'd probably be around 3,500 calories a day. If I had a plate, I would always make sure that about half my plate was a form of good, slow burning carbohydrate, like sweet potato, brown rice. Like a quarter of the plate would be, you know, protein, and like at least a quarter would be some kind of fibrous veg. Yeah, and then I'd always make sure to have fruit a few times a day. Yeah, I'd always make sure to have like a nice little post workout recovery. You know, like something like, you don't necessarily need to take supplements after training, you know, like with a glass of orange juice and maybe like hard boiled egg. So that's a good, or a banana and like some form of protein. Eggs or anything. Alright, thank you.
Time out.